Good morning to all of you. Myself Varun Saxena from Jaipur Engineering College. In today's presentation, I will conclude these things. First of all, the lab and computer environment in our college. We have 32 lecturers in CS and IT department and 12 technical assistants and one system analyst in our college. The total number of labs are 13, and we are divided it into, one lab for electrical, one for electronics, and one for mechanical, and 9 for CS and IT department. As we know that each department have some specific software for their users, so we are providing one lab for electrical and one for electronics department. We have one internet lab also. All the 12 labs are individually connected with the central server, and each lab also have a separate server for. Each lab have 25 PCs with Pentium 4 processor and 512 RAM. Internet lab have 125 PCs, SCL PCs with P4 processor and 512 RAM with UPS. There are two servers in the internet lab. One is the Xenon server with the 2 GB RAM. It is working for the domain controller, antivirus and file server, and the other is a 2000 server. We are having a 2 Mbps lease line connection with the Reliance, and in our college we have a 5 LCD projector and each one for the different department. About the teaching schedule, according to the RTU, 4 years BTech program are divided into 4 year BTech.
Sorry, what is RTU?
Rajasthan Technical University.
Oh, so for the state, you have the technical university, like in Karnataka or in Madhya Pradesh or something. Yeah. Where is the university located?
In Kota, sir.
In Kota.
Yeah. According to the RTU's university, the 4 year BTech program are divided into 8 semesters. There are six semester and 4 labs in each semester, 3 to 4 lecture in a week for a subject. The lecture timing will be about 55 minutes and one tutorial in a week with a 55 minutes. It is not necessary, it is required, if the subject required, then it will be conducted. The number of student in the batches, then I will give you the example of computer science department. There are 120 student in a computer science department. So the lecture will be, they will be divided into 2 batches, 60-60 each. Then in labs, they are further divided into 20-20 batches. In each lab section, there should be one lecturer and one TA should be there. About the evaluation scheme, the subject paper is of, the maximum marks for the subject paper is 100, 20% weightage for the 2 minor written test, and the 80% for the end term test. About the lab computing programming, the maximum marks is 100, the internal marks are 60, and the final practical marks is 40. The 60 internal marks are further divided into, first of all, the 20 marks for performance, then 20 for Viva, then 10 marks for record and 10 marks for attendance. The 40 marks for the final practical. The 30 marks are for performance and 10 marks for the Viva.
So you have actually 2 very simple divisions. No, the next one.
Yes, sir.
2 simple divisions, you have a paper of 100 marks and lab of 100 marks.
Yes, sir.
And
in first year, sir.
In first year.
Yes, sir. So and the there are 420 students in the first year.
420
students. In CS and CS electronics and electrical, there are 120 students, and in IT there are 60 students.
Yeah, but all 420 students have to do this course, no?
Yes, sir.
It is a compulsory course.
Yeah, it is compulsory.
And it is taught by CSIT department only.
Yes, sir.
So if you look at those batches of 60,
yeah.
So that means there will be 7 batches like that.
Yes, sir.
20 students.
Yes, sir. And 60 students for only for the lectures.
No, I know. For the lecture, 60 students, you will have 7 batches like that.
Yes, sir.
So are there 7 different teachers or 3 or 4 teachers take multiple batches? How is the teaching done?
Sir, one faculty will be get two sections, sir.
In 2 sections.
Yes, sir.
So 420 students means you will require 3 faculty members.
Yes, sir. 3 to 4 faculty members.
Okay, depends. 3 to 4. Sir. And the labs, the teacher which teaches a batch of 60 students.
Yes, sir.
And the lab wise, you are breaking it into 20 students each.
Yes, sir.
So the teacher will be present in the lab for each of the 20 students batch. So three times.
Yes, sir.
In a week.
In a week.
Along with the TA.
Along with the TA.
Along with the TA. I see. So that's the load on the teacher.
Yes, sir.
Do the teaching assistants or associates or technical assistants help in correcting papers or correcting assignments, or teachers have to do that?
No, no, sir. Actually, sir, the work of the lab assistant is that they are the hardware, all the hardware related problem they solve, and the assignments are also checked by the lab assistant. Because, sir, they are diploma holders, sir, so they have sufficient knowledge for it.
And 20% weightage is for the written test.
Yes, sir.
And 80% weightage is for the
end term test.
Term and paper.
Yes, sir.
Now, this term and paper is set by the university.
Yes, sir.
So, you have to work as per the set syllabus.
Yes,
so, do you have any sample of paper by any chance?
Actually, sir, I am having a syllabus copy.
Huh. Oh, this is the syllabus.
Yes,
so,
sir.
You also have this.
So, this is a syllabus for the first year.
Breaking into units seems to be a very standard procedure in most places. Unit 1, 2, 3, 4, like that.
It is a first year syllabus, and it is divided into two parts. First,
very, very interesting. I like the first word, types of computers. So, are you still talking about analog computers, digital computers, like that?
Yes, sir. First generation, second generation.
Oh, yeah. First generation,
second generation computer. So actually, sir, it is divided into two parts. Ah. The first two units are of the fundamental computers, the fundamentals of computers, and the other three are for the programming portion.
Binary, octal, decimal, hexadecimal representation, representing the characters, binary, arithmetic, then machine assembly and high level language, brief idea of my.
So, only the brief introduction about the machine assembly and
high level. But you see, in the context of the subject that we are talking about, if you look at our discussion so far, in your case, the computer programming begins halfway through unit 3 actually.
Yes, sir.
And then you have only unit 4, which is data type, constants, variables, and
but
you
sir,
have unit
but
5.
But sir, it will cover all the concepts of C, the structure and union, pointer and silent
link. I have a very strong problem with that. What is important is covering everything notionally is important, or ensuring that students understand all those concepts. So let us just compare this. You have structures, unions, pointers and file handling,
yes, sir,
as a part of unit 5. The university would have generally said units have so many hours of work. Now compare, let us say, the amount of stress that you can give through teaching and examples on pointers, on structures and on file handling. You will agree that it will be much less than what our other colleagues would be able to give because of the extra hours that they have. See, time is limited, no?
Yes, sir.
Within that time, you may do the best, but whether students will understand or not is a question.
But sir, we are giving only one month for the first two units, and the except other 4 months for the programming portion.
I see. But does the university recognize this? Do they say that the number of lecture hours or marks for different units will be graded like that? Less marks and less hours for first two units and more for the subsequent units?
Sir, in the starting of the semester, we perform a course submission plan, sir.
Course commission plan?
Yes, sir.
Course completion plan?
Completion plan, sir.
No, so there you will just, but you will still have to cover this course.
Yes.
You don't have the freedom to set question papers, right?
No, sir.
The question paper is set by?
Set by the RTU, sir.
You have no control over it.
Yes, sir.
So it is quite likely, do you have any sample of question paper by any chance?
Sir, I don't
know. Can you send a soft copy or a scanned copy later?
I definitely
send. I would like all of our colleagues to examine that and also comment. In fact, let me suggest that this kind of interaction should also work usefully for you and your university. You can perhaps take this feedback, immediately give a report to your own head of the department and to your director, and say that I met a lot of people across the country who appear to be teaching programming in a slightly different way. It appears to me to be that way is better, is more comprehensive. Here is a sample syllabus from Pune, from this, from Vellore, from here. Maybe our college should initiate something to talk to the RTU fellows who should perhaps change the syllabus. Because this is, this kind of syllabus used to be there when higher level programming languages were just coming in, when pointers were not available in fact or understood. They came only with Pascal and subsequently. Okay. Yes. But I think from a programming perspective means, of course, if you see the title of the subject, I think it is not computer programming, right? The title is something different.
Computer system and programming.
Sir. Computer systems and programming.
And so systems and programming.
A lot of computer systems and a little bit of programming is the nature of the course. Of course, you can't help it if that is the way it is.
But sir, I would like to say that now since we see that when children are coming or students are coming from different backgrounds, like we have students who have taken instrumentation. Now we have only computers, IT, electronics, EXTC and Instru. So we see that students who are from Instru or who have not done who are not from CBS or ICSE, like when we are teaching them certain things like printf, scanf statements, or in Java when we are teaching them system.out.println. So they don't exactly know what are input-output devices. Okay, so we have to tell them actually like a pipe is formed and the data comes to the screen. I'm talking about the students, the rest of the students who are not from CBSE, ICSE, because they also contribute to our results. We have to, as a teacher, make them understand. Now what there is like octal numbers, decimal numbers, like when we're teaching them logical operators. I'm not talking about the top students, I'm talking about the average and the below average student, because we have to, as a teacher, I'm responsible, as you said. You fail if in case a student fails. So I am responsible to teach him even binary, octal, decimal, if in case he has not done it before. So don't you feel so that this syllabus, before you teach a student to learn a programming language, as you, what you are saying is, I feel that programming language is a logical language and irrespective of every branch, the student should be able to program. Because engineering is after all a logical thing and you are preparing a student to think logical with this subject. That is what I understood, like what are you doing this thing for. But don't you feel so that these things will help the student to understand later on the things which they are doing more properly and help to increase the result?
Not necessarily. That's what I'm saying, that the opinion is hugely divided on this, both of the teachers and of the students. Hugely divided. That is one. Second, we grant that people should understand decimal, binary, octal, not necessarily from a computing point of view, merely as a good and useful mathematical concept. The issue is how much time you want to spend on different concepts. So whether we are doing that expenditure of time with proper relative weightage so that the main theme of the subject is not lost. That's the point.
Sir, I'll tell my experiences when I am now, suppose if in case when I'm teaching logical operators in the class, like anding, oring, or logical and bitwise operators when we teach.
Yeah, the point is when you talk about bitwise operators, and if you want to, just listen to me. If you have to give an example of, let's say, a 24-bit or 32-bit number where you are talking about bit shifting and so on, then you will require that. Why should that be known at all to a high-level language programmer who is interested in sorting addresses of people?
No, sir, but when I am teaching it through the syllabus, it is there in
the syllabus. No, you are teaching through the syllabus, that is why you are thinking like that. What I am asking is, ask whether the syllabus itself is important or is required. We have to ask every fundamental assumption that we have made in our life so far. We have to re-examine that assumption. And only if we are convinced that that assumption is correct, we go ahead. Okay, so here again, the point is, you take logical operator. The only concept that a student needs to know about logical operator is that there can be true or false. It in fact need not be represented by a binary 0 or 1 at all. Okay, the question I ask is that when you talk about peripherals and such devices, etc., etc. No, but I'm generalizing it and I'm asking you a question which a colleague of mine, Professor Dandekar at Indore, had raised when I had set up the computer science department. There was an argument that the computer science, of course, they must learn basic electronics and things like that. So he asked this question, that suppose the logic was implemented in computers instead of through electronics, through hydraulics. Then would you say that understanding of hydraulics machinery is mandatory for people to understand programming? You will say no. Exactly the same way the mechanical engineer will say, I absolutely don't give a hoot to electronics, binary representation, this, that, logic. I don't care. I am solving different problems. So please put yourself into shoes of others to see this exam. And by the way, if it is not a far-stretched thing, a colleague of mine, Professor Amarnath, who is a mechanical engineering professor, a great expert in robotics, incidentally, okay, actually has built AND OR NOR gates using hydraulics, and he uses them to explain AND OR NOT logic to mechanical engineers. So there is a limit up to which we can take it. What I would agree with you is that as a background information they should know. But how much I can tell that in exactly 15 minutes time? Should I spend 6 hours? That is the question. Because if I spend 6 hours in doing that, the number of available hours available to me to explain data structures, to explain control structures, to explain control flow, algorithms, becomes limited. It limits also my ability to discuss interesting problems whose programming solutions I want to explain to keep people interested. Remember what Professor Ranade said. So it's a question of judiciously using available time. That's all. Right. So thank you very much. I think the feedback from the group is that you better go back and do something about this course.